Hello, welcome to EdotGdot and Friends. My name is Elden Killian. I'll be your host. Today I'm joined by my good friend and brother, the big great, the great white hope, Hopey Jopey J, Ropa Dope, Joseph Killian. Welcome.
Well, welcome myself. I will welcome myself.
Yeah, that was weak sauce.
Whatever.
How you doing,
Elden?
Good. How are you? All right. Today we are going to start my new series of show called Ranking Stuff. And today we're going to be ranking Weezer. What gives us the right to rank Weezer? I'll tell you our credentials. None whatsoever. But here's a few.
Other than our fandom that we've had since they came out in 94. Me and you are the biggest Weezer fans that I currently know, and you're a bigger fan than I actually am, so that's your, you know,
right?
That's your credentials.
And your credentials are you've listened to all the albums. I
defend them even when albums aren't that great. I buy them all. I own every single one of them, and I follow them.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about how our fandom started. I know for me, it started with the Killian Corn. That's our family's business and my parents' slave driving operation, where we as teenagers spent a lot of time.
I don't know how true it is, but I always tell people I started when I was like 9 in the factory. I'm guessing about that time, and our starting wage was $3 an hour. So,
for years.
For several, although, I mean, it was money, so yeah. Whatever.
Paid once a year, right before Christmas.
We had to document our own hours on a piece of paper that do you remember that?
Like, it was on a calendar, one of mom's calendars.
Oh, yeah. It's like using my addition skills at that time. It's like, oh, I worked 45 hours this year. I'm rich.
Yeah. Anyway.
But at
Killian Corn, there was plenty of hours out of the factory, and I always say it's because Weezer was one of the few bands that like dad would like put up with.
Of course.
And so we had listened to the Blue Album multiple times in a shift.
And we never felt like we had to skip songs or have to, you know, yell when a cuss word was coming around. Like it was a very safe album.
Yeah, for sure. It was like this, and like I remember dad liked a couple songs off of Cracker.
Yeah.
He'd barely admit it, but he did.
A little more country. Yeah.
Yeah. And anyway, so I said, yeah, that's like a lot of the fandom was like, it was one of those things that we listened to a lot. We enjoyed it, but it was like one of those things we could listen to and dad wouldn't get mad at us. But when was your first concert? Do you remember?
Let's go back a second. I wanted to say this about Weezer. When I remember being up in your old room, there was a CD player up there, wasn't there? In the middle room, upstairs at one point. And I remember listening to Dookie and to the Blue Album. And that had to have been 94. And at that time, I was 11 or 12. And just going up to that room, putting the CDs in, and just listening to them over and over. And Weezer was most favorite, but Dookie was also up there. But that was like my first, like, you know, I'm 11 or 12 and just like listening to it over and over again. And that was my first like, okay, I love these guys. Like that was my first like, okay, the Blue Album, this has to be the perfect album of all time. It makes me feel like someone understands me, you know, or whatever. I mean, I didn't think of it in that way, but yeah, that was my first like just remember being up there and listening to it and just falling in love with it. But first concert was back in 96 It was at the Gorge, and it was right after Pinkerton came out. And they opened up for No Doubt, which I thought was a travesty. There's no way Weezer should have opened for No Doubt, but they did. Yeah. And, but that was my first Weezer concert.
I forgot that you were at that concert, because that was my first Weezer concert.
So
I know a bunch of people went up to it. We must have driven separately.
Maybe, but I did not go down into the pit for very long because it scared me. I was a pansy. So I went down to the pit and got like to the outskirts of it, and then people were like jumping around. I'm like, I'm leaving. So, yeah.
I mean, that's where I hang out now.
I was up on the grass the whole
time. Maybe that's why I don't remember. Yeah, I was down in the pit, and I remember I had these pair of low-top Converse, and right away, I lost one of them. Like, slipped off my shoe, and I bent over to get it. Someone kicked it, and it was gone. Just gone. So I just stayed down there the whole concert, though, just jumped up and down. And eventually, the other one started to come off, and I grabbed it real fast and stuck it in my pocket. And I tried to find another one after the concert. I never found it.
Did you get trampled on? Did your feet
On? My feet were tore up by the end. But, man, it was so much fun. And and I felt the same way. I was like, yeah, Weezer, better than No Doubt. But, man, looking back, No Doubt put on a killer show.
No Doubt had more energy. I mean, that's one thing about Weezer concerts that I'm always like, there's kind of energy, but not a ton. And, I mean, we'll get into this later, but I went to... I think the same concert you did, but I did it in Dallas, was the Weezer Panic at the Disco concert. And that was another one where Panic at the Disco put on a great show. Like, his energy is through the roof. And then Weezer is like, great. I love Weezer because you know every lyric to every song. Yeah. And so you sing the song and you scream it. But it's like if you the juxtaposition of the energy is like so ridiculously different when you. Yeah, anyways, but it was similar to the No Doubt in Weezer.
Oh, yeah, for sure. But, man.
And Gwen Stefani was awesome.
She was. She climbed up over all the way up to the top of the stage on the grid work or whatever.
And I had an incredibly big crush on her, too. So that was.
Well, there's that. yeah. So how many concerts have you been to? I've only been to 4 total lifetime.
So I went to Pinkerton for that, and then not until the Make Believe came out in 2005 did I go to another one. Mainly because I was poor, and they were never in Idaho or, you know, while we're at college or really, I don't know. So I was living in Vegas, and they were coming through. So that was my second concert. My third concert was in Oklahoma City at a casino, and that concert was awesome because it was just them. They played like an hour and 45 minutes of just their great songs. Me and my wife went, and it was like a greatest hits concert. I didn't have to sit around for a opening act that I hated or didn't know, you know, and had to act like I was into the music, you know, because that happens. But it was just Weezer for an hour and 45 minutes, and it was done, and it was awesome. And the venue was weird, though. It was in like a ballroom. Like, there was, you know, at concert venues, the stage is there, and usually, and then this was just like a flat like surface that we sat in, and it was all chairs, no moshing, nothing. It was an older crowd for sure, but it was fun because there was a lot of parents there that took their kids, that, you know, teenage kids that, you know, I think they were just happy they had something in common with their kids or whatever. But we noticed a lot of that, which was cool. And then the last concert was the Panic at the Disco Weezer concert back in, was that?
That 18? Was 17, maybe? I can't remember.
Was that after White Album?
Yeah, it was in support of the White Album.
Yeah, and they played Pacific Daydream songs, a couple of them anyways, like Feel Like Summer, I know they played. It was actually, I think it was for Pacific Daydream that concert was for, actually.
Yeah, I don't remember. I remember, like, during that tour is when they debuted, like, I Love the USA.
Yeah, yep.
In fact, I want to say your... Maybe not. I won't say that. That's probably not true. Yeah. But, but I remember that. But I remember they put in I Love the USA and they dropped LA Girls from the set list. Because I was watching the set list on website that had the set list. And I was like, ah!
you told me that. You told me that prior. Because I think you went to the first and I was like, well, they better play LA Girls. Because that's, you'll see, is my favorite song from that album.
What? But spoilers?
Yeah. No, sorry. But the other concert, so the Vegas one was actually really fun, and a funny story about it is, so Brigham Shaw was, who's our cousin, me and Eldon's cousin, he was like, hey, Weezer's going to Vegas, I live there, and he's like, let's go, it might be their last concert ever, because there was a rumor that after Make Believe that they're done, or whatever, I don't know if you remember that, but I remember that was the thing, and I'd like, Morgan was like, we don't have the money because we didn't. We were so poor.
Yeah.
And but this might be my last chance to see them, you know. And she's like, okay, relented. And I'm sure it was $50 or whatever, but that concert was incredibly fun. Me and Brigham were front row. Like, we got there super early. We rushed to the front, very front. We touched River's guitar during the concert. We touched his hand, me and Brigham, and we totally fangirled out, and it was awesome. That concert was my favorite just because of the proximity. The venue was super small. We were at the very front. We did eventually get pushed back from some unruly, you know, people, but we were up front most of the time, and it was fun. It's a good time.
Yeah, I got to see them at in Portland at the December to Remember. It was them and some band, Courtship, I think their name was. And they were actually pretty fun. But, you know, there's whoever. But, Lanae.
Well, that venue is tiny.
Yeah, at the Crystal Ballroom. It's ridiculously small.
So jealous that you got to see him there, because that would have been amazing.
Instead of fighting in the front, because Lanae and Stacy, I bought my ticket, but Lanae and Stacy had a connection, and we ended up getting VIP passes, so we got to go in the little VIP area, which is a little bit off the stage, so you could get closer if you wanted to, but we got there early enough in the VIP section that we sat right in the front of there, so, like, no obstructions. I'm sure I was obstructing all kinds of people, because I'm a giant person, but that was super fun.
Are you 6'4"?
6'4". 6'4", 6'4", and massive, so... You know, I block people's faces. But I just remember there was this drunk guy next to me. And I, you know, I was videotaping some of it. And he's like, yeah, you got to send me those videos.
let me get your number real quick.
And he was like, and I remember that concert they opened up with El Scorcho. And he, like, lost his mind. That guy was fun. Dude. Yeah, that guy was fun. Anyway, that was a great concert.
Man, yeah, those are the only, so I've only been to four also.
Okay.
Which is crazy because, I mean, obviously we're not super fans and we didn't, like, you know, travel around to see them. But when I was thinking, when you were talking about this, I was like, man, I have hardly ever seen them.
Yeah.
I think Lanae and Stacy, who are fans of Weezer, but I think they've seen them like twice as many times as we have.
Yeah, they go to a lot of concerts, though. Did you have tickets for Hell Omega before it got canceled or postponed or whatever they're calling it?
I didn't purchase them. Oh, no. Jordan, I think, bought me some, if I'm remembering. Or no, maybe I was supposed to buy them for Jordan, and I never bought them. But the plan was to go to Seattle for it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that, because me and Lanae had tickets. And me is gonna be me, Lanae, and Stacy and Jamie.
We're gonna go. So Jordan had his 20-year reunion that year or last year, and we were gonna meet in Seattle for that, and it was during that time. And we just, you know, it pretty, you know, I was like, oh, we got time to buy the tickets or whatever. And then, you know, COVID happened. And
sure. Probably smart. Yeah, I think I still have my ticket eventually if the concert ever happens. So
yeah, I'm pretty sure you can refuse it.
And that'll be fun because I've never seen Green Day live. And yeah, I'm not a huge Fall Out Boy fan, but I started listening to some of their music, and I think they're going to be fun.
Yeah, oh yeah. Fall Out Boy's got like 4 or 5 songs I like, but I don't follow them. But yeah, I'm sure just like it was with Panic at the Disco when we saw that. Like I came away really impressed with them and listened to them a lot more after I saw them live.
Oh yeah, for sure. All right, let's talk about some of our old fandom. The oldweezer.com website. You wanted to talk about this?
Which was amazing. The archives of it, the different threads or whatever, the conversations that I loved poring over, getting people's different reviews or what they thought, and it was heated, and people, you know, it was like politics today. It was like, El Scorcho is the worst song on people. No. It's the best, and you know, and just miss that, like, because I feel like a lot of people were in our shoes, like just with an incredible amount of fandom for them that we're passionate about it and whatever. And now Weezer.com right now is just like, I don't ever go to it anymore just because it's.
Yeah, it's just a depository for like, here's the band, here's where they're going to be, you know?
Yeah, and you know, and then talking about like songs from the Black Hole, like, oh my gosh, like the secret album that nobody and everybody's trying to figure out what songs would go on it or what the complete track list. And I remember one time getting home from work and Morgan was out of town and I got home from work and I literally stayed up until about 6 or 7 in the morning, just reading all of that stuff. And then like going deep dive, Googling songs from the Black Hole, like, oh my gosh, this is going to be the greatest album if it's ever released. I need to hear this crap. And I went to like the dark, I probably was on the dark web, I don't even know, but I was like looking for all of these tidbits of information and whatever. And I did that. I ended up doing that like 2 or 3 nights in a row and literally waking up, like going to bed and waking up at like 10 or 11 and going to work super late or whatever. But like, I just, that website doesn't exist anymore, and it's not, you know, it's just
yeah. So have you gone to Rivers Chat?
I have once, and I read through it's just one big thread, isn't it?
Yeah, and it keeps getting like reset. I actually don't like it, but it's a really cool project that he's doing, but I think that has the potential, like fans going and just geeking out, and that's really cool. And then on top of that, I guess we're going to talk about later, but yeah, so that website, the old Weezer.com website, I wrote a paper in school and it was supposed to be like comparing like modern music and like old music. And I totally geeked out and did a big old paper on Madame Butterfly versus Pinkerton and brought in a bunch of the songs from the Black Hole content. I remember I ran a poll on the old website and used that as part of my... Because I had to have some sort of source or whatever.
Was that your poll with the best song from Pinkerton?
Yeah, that's what it
and
was.
Didn't you do it like March Madness style?
Uh-huh. I did two on there. I did the one just for Pinkerton because I wanted that. And I did that March Madness one where like, yeah, it was... There were about 64 songs out at that point, I think.
Yeah.
And so I bracketed them. We had a vote and people made fun of it and whatever. And that was fun though.
What was the best song?
Across the Sea one.
Across the Sea, right?
Yeah. And, which is funny. It's a weird song to win something like that, but man, the fans loved it, especially back then.
At the time, I mean, nowadays it's canceled.
Oh yeah. It's creepy. It has some creepy overtones there.
Yeah.
Sort of like another song I'm going to talk about later, but
all right.
But in conjunction with that Weezer.com, you know, I remember I kind of missed Napster. Napster's already shut down. I was out of the country. I came back. It was kind of shut down. But LimeWire was still running. And I just remember ripping everything that even sniffed Weezer on LimeWire. Yeah. And that's how I consumed a lot of that stuff.
Is that where you got all the B-side stuff?
Originally, I'm sure.
So back to Killian Corn. I remember being at the factory and listening to that B-sides ripped album where it had like Devotion and Waiting on You and all that stuff. Listening to that on repeat for hours. And
isn't Waiting on You just an awesome song?
Well, yeah, and I go Pinkerton's B-sides. I know maybe we're getting ahead of ourselves. There's no other album of B-sides that compares. I mean, there's a couple songs here and there, but Pinkerton's B-sides are incredible.
And yeah,
should be their own album almost. You know, you got Waiting on You.
I think you definitely do like a Blue and Pinkerton era B-side, like Jamie and all those, and
which I guess they did. They did their
with the deluxe albums, but
deluxe albums, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
before the deluxe album, you ripped all those, and I'm grateful for it because
they're
all really good.
Yeah, me too. They're awesome songs. I remember you know, when they were doing Maladroit and Rivers like leaked all those demos on the web.
Right.
I know, leaked. He put them on the website, and the label got mad at him and all that. But
yeah, that was a fun time. I didn't hear about that because I was on my mission still.
Okay.
And I heard about it after coming back, and I'm sure you gave me all the details.
I'm sure
I did. I remember being like, wait, they were releasing songs and asking for help on which album should be on or which song should be on the album and everything. And then I always remember there was an article or an interview he did, and he was like, all the songs that they wanted were all whack or whatever.
Right.
Like everybody who voted on the songs, they were choosing the wackest songs. I don't remember what interview that was, but I remember Rivers saying something like that.
Yeah. Well, that's a whole different conversation. Are you a member of the fan club currently?
I currently am not, no.
Interesting.
I should be, but not.
It really is. It's a great community. Not that I'm super active on there, but I tell you what. Yeah. So when I got in the fan club, I bought like this bundle of stuff, which gave me like access to the fan club, and it came with a sweet lanyard, which is in the other room. But I wear it all the time. It's like my school lanyard that I wear when I go to work, and I broke it. Like was bending over and it caught on something and just ripped the metal all to shreds. And I can't remember how it came about, but somebody was like getting rid of theirs, like I think from like overseas. I was like, yeah, mine broke. Like, here, what's your address? And somebody totally shipped me theirs. And
just send it to you?
Yeah, just awesomeness. I should probably look that person's name up and give them a proper shout out, but that was super awesome. Somebody was making, being of COVID, got like some custom like Weezer fabric and was making face masks and sending them out like for donations to I think it was a women's crisis center. And you know, like that fan club is pretty awesome, like pretty great people. Cool. Because Weezer's awesome and I think attracts cool people.
One thing I will say about Weezer fans is they are usually, I mean, I think it runs the gamut. I think millions and millions of people love them and from all walks of life, but it attracts wholesome people to the wholesome music and the songs are poppy enough for enough people and they're rock enough for enough people that, you know, it works, man.
Yeah, for sure. Anyway, so what we're doing today, today we are going to go through all 14 of the albums, including Death to False Metal, the Teal album, and rank them from least favorite to favorite. We're going to share our favorite song from each album, and we're not going to be ranking Van Weezer, like the Christmas EP and stuff like that, just because Van Weezer's not out yet. I debate on Christmas EP in my mind, but it's like, it's not really an album. It's just a bunch of Christmas songs, and it's not even full. It's like, it's like seven songs long or whatever it is.
I think it's only like four. But what I will say about it is it's definitely our number one Christmas album that me as a family listen to during the year. So, or during Christmas season. Yeah.
Yeah. But before we do that, I do want to give a couple honorable mentions from the new album, Van Weezer. Which favorite song, Hero or the End of the Game?
It's probably End of the Game. It's very nostalgic to me. I actually love the video because it's that video is nostalgic. I mean, it just brings me back to being at Eric Carter's house waiting for our favorite music videos to pop up on MTV. And that was like the style almost, like, just, I don't know, the single camera following the weird dude. And like, as the, I don't know why this, but it just reminds me of the 90s so much, is this, the part of the video where all the kids are running into the living room where the band's playing or whatever, and they're just jumping around or whatever. It's like, I don't know. I mean, that sounds ridiculous, but
that was our basement a few times. Sorry, yeah. Mom and Dad, if you're watching this.
We don't have any concerts in our basement. Anyway.
Yeah. What's your, we've talked about a couple, but if you had to pick one, what's your favorite, like, random release or like movie song or extra B-side or whatever?
Favorite of all time is the song on Angus. You gave Your Love to Me Softly. I mean,
it's the best 2-minute rock song of all time. It comes out and hits it hard. Like, just,
I don't even think there's any debate. I don't know if anybody could debate that and win that argument. It's
99.9% of the population doesn't know the song, maybe.
it's 2 minutes of perfect Weezer. I mean, if there's one song you want people to hear, that would be enough.
And it's total Weezer. It rocks hard. It's got stupid lyrics. That one? It's like, still your Bijan lingers on and on. Like, where'd that come from?
I have no idea. Now, the original song that Wanda wrote for that is a great song, too.
Yeah, it's
totally different.
Yeah, and that song really fits. I really like the movie Angus.
Yeah.
You know, back in the day, there were like 3 movies I ever cried in, but there's something about like the big fat guy getting picked on that really, really touched me in a personal way.
What are you talking about? Unrelated, but the one movie that I watched over and over again and cried every single time is My Girl. So there you go.
Yeah, it's like Rudy and Angus. Those are like the 2 big ones. These days, I don't know if it's my old age, I cried everything. Coco. Oh man, Coco hit me hard. The one, I watched this movie twice. I really liked it, and I probably can't like it anymore because Kevin Spacey. But did you ever see a Kevin Spacey movie about Bobby Darin? Across the Sea or whatever? It's just a stupid biopic about Bobby Darin. And I watched it twice, and I cried in the same spot like a baby twice. For Kevin Spacey.
Listen, I mean, let's cancel him, but he's a great actor.
He is. He really is. Anyway, we kind of already talked about the Christmas EP. Also, like, the, you know, back in the day, they had those 2 Christmas songs, like the Christmas Celebration and a Christmas song, I think it's called.
Yeah.
And one of them isn't really a Christmas song, really.
Christmas song is not really a Christmas song.
Yeah.
But it's really good. I actually listen to that song quite a bit still. But yeah, I mean, all their, I love their, you know, all their takes on the traditional Christmas songs are just fun to listen to and rock. I mean, totally different than the Trans-Siberian Orchestra.
Sure.
but still rock nonetheless, singing about the sweet baby Jesus. So.
And then you are big into the Alone albums as well as I am.
Yes, the first two especially. The first two I listened to a ton. I purchased both of them and listened to them a million times. They just had some great songs, you know. I love the kind of the look back behind the curtain of Rivers, you know, and seeing like what he was into and the weird stuff he was doing. But some of it's like hits really good, like, you know.
I have them, like, you can get them on, like, iTunes now or Apple Music or whatever they're calling it now. But, like, the booklet was, like, the best part of that, of those albums. Just getting that little sneaking peek. And so, related to that, have you gotten into any of the Dropbox dump?
I have not done the Dropbox. It sounds overwhelming. I am busy with my work, and it's like, I want to. What I want is somebody to listen to all of it and then drop like the best stuff.
Yeah.
Because how many hours and hours of stuff is it? I mean, it's a ton, right?
Hundreds.
Yeah. So it's like.
So
I hope
the only one I've paid to unlock is the very first one that they did, the U-Bait years.
Uh-huh.
And I haven't listened to everything on there. I've been trying to skip ahead and like find things I know that are like, actually songs. And I've listened to a few of them. There's some good stuff there. And it's really interesting. There's like 20 different versions of like Anonymous. And like kind of, and like the progression of like where that song started and where it ended up is pretty rad. And cool. Like I don't know. Stuff like that's super interesting. The other really cool thing in there is like there's a bunch of like artwork and stuff. And like some of it's like the inspiration of songs and some of it is like, you know, whatever, like alternate album covers or ideas. And that stuff's really interesting too. And then if you go along with that, with on the Rivers, was it riverscuomo.com? Like he has like a Wikipedia that is sort of like those liner notes that are just super interesting. But anyway.
What about this is along the same vein a little bit, but the movie that they released, and I'm
Video Capture Device. I've never actually seen it.
You had it?
No.
I own it, although the disc is damaged, but I watched that. It's really cool. I mean,
I'll have to watch that.
It's really interesting. I believe it's during the Green album, a lot of the Green album, and maybe Melodrama. Yeah, I think it's the Green album because they like photograph. I'm just trying to remember.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I kind of remember when that came out. And that was about those years, like right around I think it came out about the same time as Maladroit, so after the Green tour.
That's right. That sounds right.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out. I actually haven't seen it. But yeah, it sounds amazing.
Yeah, Morgan bought it for me. I think for my birthday one year. So
you have the wife of the year. All right, so we've been jabbering on for like 30 something minutes. So let's now to the main event. All right, so my number 14 is Matchy. Ooh. We got the same one. Both of us hate the same album, and that is Death to False Metal. In fact, you didn't even rank this one. Like, you ranked all of them.
So, I know it was released, and I bought it at Best Buy. I remember buying it, and it was released. But I listened to it several times, and really the only songs that really caught my attention were... I actually really liked the one that he did with the fans, Turning Up the Radio.
Yeah, and song. I loved watching that series. And I was so when it came out, I was like, "Oh, that's awesome!" Yeah, you finally get to hear like the culmination of this really cool project. I remember seeing an interview. He said, "I was like, I'll probably never do this again." Like, I think it was hard, but
the song. I mean, does it sound like Weezer? Yeah, does it sound like a generic Weezer song? Totally, but it's a good song.
Yeah,
it's good.
Yeah. So anyway, your favorite song on this album is "I Don't Want Your Lovin'."
Because it's just a great rock song, man. I love the kind of towards the end of the song where, you know, not that I want.
Sorry. Do a little clip here. It does. It comes out rocking.
Yeah.
Anyway, I don't want to play too much of it, so I don't get a copyright strike on the...
You know, the is it the chorus where he's like, I don't want your loving. And it's just that, you know, I love when he gets all, I don't know,
sentimental. I don't want your love. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you know what? The rest of that, I actually dislike a ton of songs on this album. This one,
yeah.
Turn Up the Radio is pretty good, but my favorite is actually... this one. The old cover of Unbreak My Heart.
Yeah, it's good. So what I dislike about this album...
Oh, played it again on accident.
What I dislike about this album is all the songs, I mean... They are, I mean, they're from decades past, and he tried to finish producing them or whatever, but they still feel incomplete to me. They still, there's about five songs where I like 10 seconds of it.
Yeah.
You know, like Autopilot, the bridge is the only part of that song that I like, but I'll listen to it because it's a good 15 seconds worth of music, you know?
Yeah.
But there's a lot of that in that album.
Yeah, for sure. I think like for some reason on my just Apple Music, when I put on shuffle, what's the song that comes up all the time? Trampoline. I hate that song. Like, it's so terrible. Yeah. Trampoline. And it comes up all the time.
It's such a bad 90s generic grunge. I don't even know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man, I couldn't have Lover in the Snow on there. Come on.
Yeah. Great.
All right, moving on, number 13. We matchy-matchy again. This might be a really boring list here. Teal Album. Album of covers. And again, I don't think you wanted to rank this one, but it is a Weezer album, and so it gets ranked.
I guess I didn't want to because it's not a Weezer album. I mean, it's just a bunch of covers, but I mean, with their own spin and I actually, me and my girls listen to it a lot. I mean, you know, they like listening to it. They like hearing it.
Yeah. The one thing about this album is like the songs I like the most off of it are, you know, they didn't make any like huge risks on any of these covers.
Yeah.
They are very faithful. And so like there's songs I like Take On Me. I like Take On Me. And they do a good job of it. Africa is maybe not my favorite song, but they do a good job with it. Let's see.
Why didn't they put Rosanna on it?
Because Rosanna is better. Oh, well, they didn't because the whole reason they did Africa was...
Right.
And having two songs by Toto on one cover album is kind of...
They didn't want to put Rosanna.
I don't know. It's just kind of weird to have two cover songs from the same band on your cover album, but I think. And Africa was huge. Anyway, but your favorite song that you told me was this one. Anyway, Mr. Blue Sky.
Well, when you just listen to the first 10 seconds of it, then...
Mr.
Blue Sky, it's just a really good song, and I like their take on it, which is very faithful, but I think
it is different. The ELO version's very technically like on point, and I think Weezer, you know, I'm sure they did it in like three takes, right?
Yeah.
I don't know. And then my favorite is Turtles, Happy Together. And this was a song that they, the last time I saw them live was actually, I don't know if you could see my shirt here.
No.
It says, Jamie, I'm so glad you're mine. It has a little Weezer thing.
Yeah.
This was my...
See what I just did? I tried to see...
No, but
I'd be able to see down by... Yeah, anyway.
But my wife's name is Jamie, and I met her, or my our very first date was at a Weezer concert, and her friend made this shirt for me. So she has a shirt that says Jamie on it, and mine says, awesome. Jamie, Jamie, I'm so glad you're mine. I guess anyway, and but this song was, they played this song on that tour before Till album came out. Like, it was just part of, and they and Take On Me Too was another cover they did during that tour. And man, I thought live they played it really well. I was glad it was on this album because the world deserves Weezer doing the Turtles.
Doing the turtle. I got
you. Anyway, okay, number 12. I want another Matchy Matchy.
Oh.
Hurley.
Oh. Yes.
Yes. Sorry. Well, I don't know. I just wrote down what you told me. The fun thing about Hurley is the actor George Garcia, who played Hurley, who's the picture of the album, he's sort of a celebrity in my other big hobby, which is board games, which is what's behind me. Oh. And so he, anyway, every once in a while he shows up on podcast and board game related content.
What's his favorite board game? I need to know.
I don't know off the top of my head. He likes, okay, if I remember right from some of the things I've listened to him, he likes sort of like what I call like Ameritrash type stuff, which is not necessarily what I like a lot, but have you ever played like Betrayal, House on the Hill, stuff like that?
Yeah, I hate that stuff.
I think that's the stuff that he likes. But I don't remember. George, if you see this, you can correct us.
I'm already
bored. Anyway, so yeah, what's wrong with this album, I guess?
A lot's wrong with it, but there's still some great songs on it. I mean, there's three or four that I still enjoy listening to, but there's a lot of trash on it that I'm just not, you know, yeah, I'm skipping. Yeah.
And this is, do you have the playlist in front of you of the whole album?
I can pick it up.
Is this the one that has train wrecks on it, or is that
Memories and
I think train wrecks is the perfect song for this album. Because the album's a train wreck. But you can't look away from it sometimes. But Memories, I actually like train wrecks. I think that's a really good song. Let's see. You said your favorite off this album, though, was let's see if we can bring it on. Yeah, Hang On. Get a little snippet here. It's a little different.
Yeah. Yeah. The song is Weezer to me.
Go ahead.
Weezer to me is, if it's got a great chorus, I'm sticking around for it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Even the verses are great in it. But I just really like the chorus, and I like when Rivers has emotion while singing. I don't know, like.
What's the lyric? It's like, hang on till I see you again.
Hang on. Yeah. And
you're more than a friend, something like that, right?
Yeah. Just like. So yeah, I mean, it's just a good song. It's happy. It's just something I can listen to and sing along to. So this has Memories, Ruling Me, Train Wrecks, Unspoken, which Unspoken's actually a great song too. But then the awful song, Where's My Sex?
Oh, I like Where's My Sex.
No, you do not.
I do.
No.
In fact, I wish I had a different lyric because the lyric, I think, kind of does downgrade it. But I think it's the funnest song on the album.
Oh, my gosh. And you know what? Smart Girls.
I like Smart Girl. I like Smart Girls, too. I think we like different three or four songs on this album is what it comes down to. Anyway, my favorite on this album, though, is Time Flies, actually. I like this sort of like retro-y, guitar-y, funky sliding thing.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good song.
Anyway, which actually, this brings up a point to me. One thing Weezer does really well on every single one of their albums is close it. Like the last song on every album, I think, is just.
Oh, that we should have made that a topic. What's the best, or you know,
the best closer? Because there's a couple that are awesome. All right, so let's go on next one. So my number 11 is we matchy again. What? We all hate the same Weezer albums in the exact same order. But anyway, Black Album, which I actually don't hate this album. But it has some unevenness to it.
Yeah. There's three or four songs that I really like. I actually was debating on which my favorite song was between three songs, really. What's the kite one?
High as a Kite.
High as a Kite. And then, Prince, who wanted everything or whatever.
Uh-huh.
This is how much I love it. let's see here. High as a Kite, and then the Prince who wanted everything. And then my favorite song that I put on the list was California Snow.
Yeah, let's listen to that one for a second. I have to do this hand motion every time.
Sweet, sweet, sweet guitar riffage. Right there. Oh, yeah.
Woo! I remember, so that song came out before Black Album. It was on the some movie, Spell, I think, is the name of the movie. And I didn't love it. I thought it was interesting. But here's another one. This is the closer to the album. And when it gets to the end of the album, I think it's just perfect. Like, it just closes out. And when it's in the flow of the album, like, I end up liking it, like, you know, a couple years ago, I ranked all of the Weezer songs, and I think I had this like at probably like 100-ish somewhere in there. I think it'd be much higher if I was to do that list again.
Yeah. California Snow is a great song. You know, it's weird and rappy almost. You know what? I don't even know how to describe it, but it's got a sweet guitar riff, and I love it. I listen to that. High as a Kite. The worst song is Can't Knock the Hustle. I can't stand that song with a passion, but there's three or four songs that really
I don't like that one so much. And I'm forgetting the track list. What's before A Byzantine? Is that a Prince?
Byzantine. Winner? I like Byzantine. Is that too many? The Prince Who Wanted Everything? Is that?
No, what's the one before that then?
I don't know. Hold up.
Whatever, it doesn't matter. There's one of those songs I just really dislike, which is, I think, is why it drops the album so low for me. There's just a couple songs that are like the same thing. Can't Knock the Hustle. Yeah. It's just too not good Weezer-y, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if I hate it, but it's just not a great song for me. Zombie Bastards, I don't think is excellent. Yeah. But I really like This Is My Favorite. And this is one of their all-time great videos.
Yeah. Really good.
Yeah. That one. Yeah. And then for a long time, I would have said my favorite was actually Living in L.A. And I still really like it, but I think High as the Kite is my current favorite off that album.
Yeah, it is a good song. I enjoy it. My daughters love it. You know, I make sure when I'm listening to Black Album, you got to skip a couple with them. But
yeah,
but High as a Kite, Prince Who Wanted Everything, California Snow. I mean, honestly, there's only like two that I skip, and that's more for language than anything.
Yeah, I don't care about language. My kids go to public school.
Mine do too. I try and keep up appearances.
Yeah. All right. So number 10. My number 10 is higher on your list, so you like this album. Your number 10 is higher on my list. So yes. Starting to diverge just a little bit here. Number 9. Oh, higher on your list. Higher on your list. I'm sorry, guys. Eventually we'll catch up to the albums. Number 8. Pacific Daydream. This was actually your number 9, I believe.
Number 9.
Yeah. So, and I'll, we flip flop. Our number 8, number 8, 9 were flip flopped. So, anyway, Pacific Daydream. This was my least favorite when it first came out. Yeah. I forced myself to listen to it probably about 10 times, and it just keeps growing on me, is what it comes down to.
Yeah.
And, even like QB Blitz, which is just kind of a dumb song, it's good. It's a good song.
Yeah. And La Mancha Screwjob.
Yeah.
Dumb name of all time is a great song.
It is.
Sweet Mary. Beach Boys is even good. I don't hate it.
I think Beach Boys might be my least favorite on the album, but Sweet Mary, that chorus, and yeah, I dare you not to sing along with that.
Yeah. And then even Weekend Woman, I love it.
I really like Weekend Woman. Yeah.
So the two, my least favorite songs on these were the two releases, which was Feels Like Summer and Happy Hour. I do not like those songs. And I think it's because they're too poppy. They're too, I don't know, or they're trying to be too popular. I don't know. I dislike those songs. I think they were the two biggest songs on the album, weren't they?
I have a hard, well, I think the biggest song maybe was the one that you have listed as your favorite.
No.
Maybe. It has the best video.
Feels Like Summer.
No. Your favorite. Your favorite was this one.
Well, no. Mexican Fender is my favorite.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Feels Like Summer does the best.
Maybe. Man, that's a great guitar.
Yeah.
When I first heard this, I was like, this album's going to rock. And I think I was disappointed. And that's why I didn't like it for so long.
Yeah.
That's a great line, too. And, yeah, that's a good song. But I actually, you hate it. It's my favorite song on the album. It wasn't at first, but I'll tell you when it became my favorite was at this concert that I went to. It was in Seattle at the what's that venue called? It's an outdoor amphitheater, and it was a great set list, and they brought it hard. Like when I watched them at December to Remember, it was just they played like 45 minutes or an hour or something like that, and then they got the stage, and it was just, you know, it was the biggest hits and a Pixies cover, and then they were out and whatever.
Yeah.
But at this one, they played Feels Like Summer. And they, I don't know if it's just practice, they'd gotten around and they got really good at playing it live. And I appreciate the song more for sure.
Yeah.
And I don't know, something about seeing it live and them rocking it live was like, it took it over the top to me. And I started liking that one. Talk about like top 3 songs in this album. Mexican Fender, great song. And then for me, Feels Like Summer. And, just Sweet Mary, Weekend Woman. Good songs.
Yeah.
Good songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, Beach Boys. I don't know about that song. Which is probably what drops it a little lower for me.
Yeah, it's whatever. I mean, it's a fun song. Whatever.
Yeah. And then your number 8 and my number 9 is Make Believe. And this was, I think, commercially maybe their best album.
Definitely the I don't know about the album, but
they
I
won a Grammy Beverly for Hills. It I believe.
Yeah, Beverly Hills was definitely like the longest number one, you know,
their
song or whatever. It got the highest on the Billboard or whatever,
right?
But it was I couldn't go freaking 3 hours listening to the rock stations or even pop stations in St. George. I was in St. George, Utah when this came out. It was playing all the freaking time.
Yeah.
All the time. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember Beverly Hills when it first came out. I remember I was at the Killing Corn Factory working. I downloaded it online to listen to it. And I remember I was like, man, that's a weird song.
I did too. The first, it was so funny because I remember the first time I listened to it. And I'm like, this sounds like Weezer, but I don't think it is. This must be a new band or something. Yeah. But then, literally, the first time I heard it, and then I had to Google it, I'm like, oh, that is Weezer. Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think this like brought them, I don't know, maybe not back, but I think after Maladroit was kind of a bummer, I think, on the fans, and then this came back, and
I think this had broader appeal.
Yeah,
for sure. A lot of people love, especially Beverly Hills, and then even Perfect Situation was big on heavy rotation on MTV. I remember,
yeah,
like, watched it all the time. So
it has a really good video. I'm a little sad that Elisha Cuthbert didn't get like kidnapped during it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was this before or after 24? And she was like perpetually being kidnapped multiple times a day.
Yeah.
Anyway. Where are we at? I think what makes this album not like one of my favorite ones and brings it as low as it did for me is there's just some songs in there I feel are weak.
Yeah.
And there's some really, I think, like, yeah, I think Beverly Hills, Perfect Situation are just killer songs, but there's just some weak songs on it, you know?
What's the one about a spider? Like, I can't stand that.
That's from the Red album, I think.
No. Maybe it is. Haunt You Every Day, I don't like.
Yeah.
Although I don't hate.
I'll tell you the song I don't like is the one...
Pardon Me? It's Pardon Me.
Oh, I love Pardon Me. That's probably my third favorite song on the album. But the one that I don't like is, and I hate the song, is This Is Such a Pity, or This Is a Pity. Yeah.
And that was a single, I think, their fourth single on it. Yeah, ugh, horrible.
Terrible song. And even like We're All on Drugs, it's an okay-ish song.
I don't like it.
My ex-wife hated it.
Yeah, I don't like it either.
Anyway. Anyway, so we both we matchy-matchied on Black Album for our favorite song, and that was we already talked about it. Perfect Situation.
Man.
This song live when everyone starts doing the O-O's,
oh yeah,
is just chilling, you know.
It's a great song. I like Weezer's epic songs.
Yeah.
You know, this I think is more epic, definitely, than like Photograph, you know.
The epic sing-alongs. Oh man, I don't know if I've ever seen them play Photograph live. I'd like to see that, actually.
That would be fun.
Yeah, do you have like your list of songs like you'd love just,
oh my god,
you know, just pee your pants if they played live?
Oh yeah, and they'll never play
ever.
You know, that's what's so sad is I wish I could have gone to the Blue Album and Pinkerton concerts where they just played album front to back, because I would love to hear some of their song, like on the Blue Album, number three. Why can't I think of?
Let's see.
There's a
no, World is Turning. No one else.
Yeah. No one else in The World Has Turned and Left Me Here, like songs that they would never play live normally.
I feel like they played The World Has Turned, Left Me Here at December to Remember.
Oh, really?
I'm trying to remember if that, maybe that's a false memory. Yeah. But I remember we left the concert and Stacey was like, there's a song that I didn't recognize. I think that was the one he was talking about. Yeah.
Cool.
Anyway. And that was one cool thing about, like, during the COVID thing, where, like, Rivers was doing those, like, Island in the Zoom concerts. Do you ever watch any of those?
Yeah.
So he was...
No.
So he had, like, a computer program make the set list for those, and it brought up some random crazy stuff sometimes. And you could tell, like, he hadn't played those songs in a decade sometimes. He's like, you know.
Cool.
But those, you know, the sound quality was so terrible, it kind of ruined it. But those were fun. Yeah, anyway. He played Waiting on You at one of them.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, that was awesome. Yep. Anyway, let's move on to number seven.
Okay.
My number seven was your number 10. This is Ratitude. Cool. And I know a lot of people dislike Ratitude. But...
because of the name, let's be honest.
But there...
get past the title.
But there's one song on there that if it was the only song and the rest of it was just white noise would make this number seven for me. And we'll talk about in just a second. But there's other good songs. And yeah, some of the lyrics are so fun. Like, what's the one that's like, this is terrible. It's a fun lyric, but I can't remember it. I'm terrible at lyrics, by the way. Anyway. I'm Your Daddy is kind of a weird song. And it is weird lyrically.
Yeah, I love I'm Your Daddy, though.
It is hilarious, fun. And this is the album that has The Girl Got Hot. Man, I love that song. Yeah. That song is great.
Put Me Back Together. That's the one I think
Put Me Back Together. I like that song.
They wrote that with another band that I'm blanking on. A band that I'm sure is a carbon copy of Weezer. Why am I blanking on their
Ozma or something?
Yeah, I don't know.
Don't remember. I don't remember. Anyway, but the song that just is my song on this one this one, and it was both of our favorite song from the album.
Yeah.
And another great video. I think
really good video.
Real fun, cute, innovative, and fun. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just a good album. Let's see here. Your number 7's gonna be higher on my list. Interesting. All right, number 6. Oh, higher on your list, and your number 6 higher on my list. So we're getting there. So we're getting to some convergence, I think. Number 5, ooh, a matchy-matchy. And this is Everything Will Be All Right in the End.
You bait.
This was, I think, universal. Everybody is like, okay, Weezer's back.
Yeah.
I
love that album more when it came out the first year or so than I do now, but I still really like it.
Yeah, I think same for me. It slipped a little bit. I think the White Album kind of ruined this album for me, which surprises higher on my list. We haven't seen it yet.
Yeah. Well, it's because it's lower on my list.
Is it? I don't know. Spoiling things.
Nope. Anyway, so what I really liked about this is it did. It brought back a lot of their... some solos are in it. Some
epic solos.
Epic solos. Some good just choruses and riffs and all that stuff that you just you love about Weezer. And it seemed like they got away from the pop. Like I'm excited about this. Like it's more rock. So I loved it.
Because this came off of like Hurley, which didn't do great. Which came off of Ratitude, which people generally dislike.
Right.
And then I think a lot of, and this is in the era where that comedian, Hari Kondabolu, whatever his name is, has that epic rant about what happened to Weezer. Like that blew up on the internet.
Yeah.
And then they come out with this and I think everybody's like, kind of shut up,
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it was a good album to come out with, and I like them all. I listen to that front to back, really.
Yeah, and I think I did. And eventually, though, there are some weak spots, I think, for me. Like, Da Vinci is, like, one of my all-time least favorite Weezer songs of all time.
I really like that song.
And I think that's a song that probably we diverge the most on. If we were going to rank all the songs... Like when I ranked all my songs, there was like 200 something Weezer songs I ranked, and it was like 190 or something like that. and everything below it was either on Death to False Metal or like some weird something that was like on Lion the Witch EP or I hate that song.
So what's your favorite song on this?
So your favorite? Well, let's see your favorite song because that's the way I put the list together.
Right.
Your favorite song is actually really hard to do a sample of, but
The Future Scope Trilogy.
Yeah, The Future Scope Trilogy, which is a 3-part song. This part is Wasteland.
Yeah.
I probably should have put all three songs in there so we could just skip ahead a little bit. I like, of that part, Anonymous is my favorite part of it, but then also like at the end where it's just like the solo goes crazy.
Oh, yeah, and it's a great solo too. Like it's, it's really good.
Rivers is showing off his chops on the guitar there.
Yeah, for sure.
And I know, like, I've heard, like, Scott Schreiner say, like, he wishes they could play that live. Like, he brings the double neck guitar to every show, just hoping it'll get make it on the list, you know?
Just in case they could play it.
Yeah. And I think I heard him say that on an interview. Anyway, but my favorite song is, you know, the one thing Weezer does is end songs really well, which the Future Scope Trilogy is ending the album. They also begin albums really well, I feel.
Yeah.
And the beginner on this one starts with that feedback and then that little whisper. Is that sampled for something, or did they get actors to do that? Because man, that guitar! I remember I watched one of those, like, somebody reviewed the album, and I think it was his first listen, or he faked it real well. He was like, "What? Huh?
Yeah,
it's amazing! Oh yeah, Weezer's back!" Like, because I think that was missing on Hurley and Ratitude, that guitar right there.
Yeah. Now, Back to the Shack is your least favorite, right?
No, Da Vinci by far.
Back to the Shack, I cannot listen to that.
I like Back to the Shack. Maybe not my favorite, but I like it. Yeah. I really like Lonely Girl, fun song. I like the duet.
Eulogy for a Rock Band is actually probably my second favorite on this. Lonely Girl's great. Go Away's pretty good.
Yeah.
That one girl. Cleopatra, I really like. I like them all, man. Honestly, I like
Cleopatra's a little corny, but it's fun. I can listen to it.
The British Are Coming. That's always good.
His falsetto in that.
Yeah, his voice gets way up there.
Yeah. But, anyway.
Well, cool.
Man, I'm excited to talk about these next albums. Like, I just love these albums so much. All right. So let's move on to number four. And I think, no, this is not a matchy-matchy. Green Album. This is your number seven. And I go back and forth on Green Album all the time. Like, sometimes I'm like just done with it. Because the one thing about the Green Album is, like, all the songs, like, there are seven songs on there that are the same song. Like,
dude, it's 24 minutes or however long it is, and you put it in, and if you're not paying attention to the album, it's over.
Right.
And you don't know if I heard a different song. Like, it's definitely like that.
Yeah. And but those, you know, those songs that sound all the same, they're good songs. They're good pop songs.
They're really good. Yeah.
They're good pop rock songs.
I saw them on Saturday Night Live play, and when I can't remember the song. I mean, they played two songs off this album, and I was like blown away. I just remember being like, they're back. I can't believe they made another album after, you know, the two prior to it, and I was just so happy that they came back that I think I overlooked how simple it was, but I was just like, dude, this is Weezer. I'm so excited, you know.
Yeah.
I'm so excited to listen to it over and over again too.
Did you ever listen to the podcast We Are Weezer?
I've listened to
They go through all the albums and they kind of rank all the songs. No. They talk about all the songs. The one thing I knew this, but when they talked about, like, really, like, the thing about this album is most, like, the guitar solos are short and they're all just like copies of the chorus.
That's cool.
You know?
Yeah.
And which is fun, but it just, it's just super simple pop songs and they don't take any risk. They're all short. I don't know, they're so good. But you know, the big song, Island in the Sun, I think is the one that blew up the biggest. And that's a good song. I remember you weren't on the cruise. When we went on the family cruise, somebody did it during karaoke, not in our family. That was fun.
Yeah. Cool.
And that's just a good song. But our favorite is we matchy-matchied on this one, yeah. And although I love, like, so before we say it, like, I love Don't Let Go, Photograph, great song.
Yeah.
Is Oh Lisa on the album or is that a B-side?
Girlfriend.
Oh Girlfriend's on the album, which is a good song.
Yeah.
Oh Lisa was a B-side. And that's a good song. Teenage Victory. Oh, the B-side, you know, B-sides on this might be as good as the Pinkerton ones. Teenage Victory song.
They are really good. Teenage Victory, yeah, they are good.
The sad thing about these B-sides is they are not on any music service. Like,
really?
So, like, you can't get them on Apple Music or Spotify or Pandora or anything like that.
They never released a, whatever they call it, the
deluxe edition.
The deluxe edition, they never released one.
I think the other ones were on the 20-year. Would that have been this year? This year would have been the 20-year anniversary.
2001. So no, 2001 is.
So maybe they'll do it this year. Yeah. Hopefully, because I love the B-sides from this era, and I miss them, but I can't bring them up on my Apple Music.
Adeline, that's a great one.
That's from the blue.
Lies. Okay.
The barbershop one.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's from Blue Album. My Adeline.
Like we'll find out. Anyway,
our favorite song is. I remember the first time I saw this video and just like laughing and like epic. The sumo wrestlers. On the old Weezer.com, they talk about how cool the old Weezer.com was. They had a little video game that you could play with the sumo wrestlers.
Yeah, cool.
That was fun.
Yeah, Hashpipe is just a banging song, man. It's just a good song.
Yeah, let's see here. Red Album is your number 4. This was my number 6. And I would... this one would be higher. This may be maybe not fair. It has the greatest B-side, I feel. That's high praise. A really great B-side. But most of the B-sides I really dislike. And there's also 3 or 4 songs on this album that I really dislike. And because of that... I have to discount it.
This album to me is 1 through 6 and then 10. I do not listen to 7, 8, or 9.
Yeah.
1 through 6 and then 10 and then 11, which is your side, Miss Sweeney.
Yeah.
And then I'm done with the Red Album.
Yeah.
But the songs that I do like, I think are on par with some of their better albums. I wish they told Scott Schreiner and Pat Wilson to not sing on, because their songs are terrible. I'm sorry.
In case you see this, I love you, Pat, and I love you, Brian. Don't listen to my brother. I do hate Brian's singing voice. He's so great as a backup vocalist, but like every song like that he takes the lead vocals on, and like his side project, I have a hard time listening to it. And it's nothing personal. I just, great musician, and I love you, but
he's just, not the music. We don't like his music. All
right. Anyway, 1 through 6. The video for Pork and Beans is, man, they're so good at making like these iconic, amazing videos. Yeah. And Pork and Beans video is as good as any of them. Getting all those old YouTube people.
And then The Greatest Man That Ever Lived is such. It's such an epic song. There's a couple parts of that song that I don't like, but it's just like 5 minutes of pretty freaking awesome. Like
Is it five minutes long? I think it's longer than that even.
Yeah, or six. Yeah, whatever it is.
It's a great song.
I love that song. It's not my favorite.
My good friend, Eric Herman, who's a musician, for his like birthday last year, he did like this like 24-hour on like streaming, like playing music, like like some of it was just him noodling around on his guitar, but he had a section where like if you made a donation to some charity or whatever, he'd play whatever you want. And so I told him ahead of time, I was like, I'm going to donate some money and I want you to play The Greatest Man That Ever Lived. And then I gave him an out. I was like, you don't need to do the whole song. Just part of it.
Did he know how to play it?
He learned it. And he played, he played the guitar part and then sang a little bit at the beginning and the chorus. But, that was good enough. Yeah, that's a big ask for someone to learn for a... But, just so fun. I love the story about it. It's like taking this phrase, the greatest man that ever lived, and like how would different musical styles interpret that phrase and like and mesh it all together in like this epic awesomeness.
I love the version or the video. It's not, there's no video of it, but it was some award show that they played it live and cut it off early or whatever. But it's pretty freaking epic. If you, it's Jack Black was the host, I think, of it or something.
Oh yeah,
like a gaming video award show or something. Yeah,
it's like the Nickelodeon award show. I feel like I've seen this before on YouTube. Maybe.
Yeah.
This is my song that if I like had a wish like. What song do you want to watch Weezer play live? This is the one.
Yeah. I definitely want
to play live. Oh, Grace May Overload. But yeah, but then like I was like Troublemaker. I love Troublemaker. I'm forgetting the name of the song. What are those first six? Do you have the list up?
Dreamin'.
I love Dreamin'.
Yeah. It's a little weird, but it's awesome also like
it's taking the edge off right and it's a little more Beach Boy-y and
so we got Troublemaker, The Greatest Man That Ever Lived, Pork and Beans, Heart Songs, Everybody Get Dangerous.
You're an idiot.
And then Dreamin'.
I don't like Heart Songs a ton. Yeah, I listened to it just to get to the next one.
Yeah, Dreamin' is such a great one, but
before we reveal your favorite song and talk about it, I just want to just give this song its due. It's a B-side, Miss Sweeney.
Okay.
I didn't hear the song for a long time because I was poor when this came out, and I only got the regular album, and the only way you get Miss Sweeney is if you got the deluxe album. And this was before like everybody put everything on YouTube, and for whatever reason I didn't hear the song for years, but I finally, you kept telling me, it's like, yeah, it's the Miss Sweeney, and so I did. It is just amazing. It's weird. Like the you know, the verses are weird, but weird. They build a story. A story when he gets that part where he's like Miss Sweeney, I'm totally in love with you.
Yeah.
Or where? Totally not. Anyway, I'm messing it up, but.
You make a raindrop disappear.
Yeah. That is just a great crescendo. Just fantastic song. But your favorite song, and this is going to be a tricky one to play because it's like quiet for like the first minute.
But it's so good.
It is. And you turn this one on to me. I was kind of like so on this one.
Yeah.
But this one, along with like Only in Dreams, it took me a while to appreciate because I think you have to listen to it really loud. And in a quiet environment.
With headphones on and just you're going to be eloquent. So.
And then. I'm going to jump ahead because the best part of the song is like the. And we skipped everything to get there, and it all builds to that those oohs and just. It's like emotional. Yeah. It's like a religious experience almost.
Yeah. When the crescendo of it and getting to the point where he's just like so emotional about what he's singing about, it's like, okay, this is awesome. Like this is. The debate for me, and it might not be for anybody else, but top closing songs of any album by Weezer is one or two, and it changes for me. It's Only in Dreams or this song or
Butterfly doesn't get into the conversation there.
I mean, Butterfly is incredible and I love it, but
it's not emotionally soaring like Only in Dreams and this one are.
Yeah, I mean, but Butterfly. Man,
let's make another video where we talk about just
the
closing songs. Yeah. We could probably talk an hour about those. All right, my favorite song though is and we talked about it at length, is The Greatest Man That Ever Lived.
Yeah, such a good song. This is, I believe, Lene's favorite Weezer song of all time.
Yeah, Lene calls it the Bohemian Rhapsody. Yeah, Weezer's Bohemian Rhapsody. This has a slow start too.
Yeah, a little bit.
I like how it flips into the siren.
Yeah.
This has the greatest.
It's so nerdy and dumb and awesome. All
right. This has the greatest line I used to say to my kids all the time whenever they tell me, "I don't like that." Oh, you love it? And that makes them so mad. Anyway, okay, let's move on to the next one. Our number three, mine, is the White Album. For me, there's like a leap here, actually. It's like my number one and my number two White Album, and then there's like a little bit of a gap, and then everything else. This is like from top to bottom, 1 through 10. I don't... And even like the... the B-sides or like the ones that were released afterwards, the
Those are great.
Fake Smiles and A Friend of a Friend. Ugh, man, those are good. Killer songs.
Yeah.
And I love this album. Like, in fact, nowadays I probably listen to it the most. I think I still recognize my number one and number two as like two of my favorite albums of all time. Like they'll always be in the top 10.
Yeah.
Of all time, of anything I ever listened to. And then the White Album is probably just right outside that top 10. But I love it.
It is a really... in fact, looking at my list, it seems egregious where I put mine.
You put it at number 6. Which, you know, it has to go somewhere. But
yeah.
I'll gush over it.
Right. It's from... You know, Thank God for Girls, I don't love.
Yeah, that's probably the weakest song on the album, but I still like it.
Endless Bummer is a closer, and that's a great song.
That's good.
Summer Elaine and Drunk Dory, Do You Want to Get High? When Do You Want to Get High actually came out, it was the second single from it, and the album hadn't come out yet. Like, that to me was like epic Weezer. Like, when I first heard it, I was blown away by Do You Want to Get High. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, this is everything that I've ever wanted in a Weezer song. Until I heard my favorite.
Which I don't, yeah, let's just talk about it. Whatever. We're getting long-winded here. Your favorite, and this was my favorite for a really long time, but recently I've had a swap. Man, I love that reverb.
Yep. Yeah.
Do you know what he's saying right there? Do you know the lyric?
Geyer and Gimbo.
Yeah.
In the Wave. Isn't that from
the Jabberwock?
Alice in Wonderland. Yeah,
the Jabberwocky poem from Lewis Carroll. Lewis Carroll?
Something like that. Yeah.
Who wrote Alice in Wonderland? Anyway, but yeah, super nerdy. But yeah, such a good song. Like, in a rock and like classic Weezer way. The video is great. All the videos on this are amazing, I think.
Yeah.
Except for the Do You Want to Get High one, which is just the weird Morphe thing. But
is that the only Weezer song that starts out with the chorus? I know there's got to be more.
I'm not as big of a music nerd as you would think.
Yeah.
And so I don't keep track of stuff like that, but maybe.
I can't think of another one where he just goes into the chorus. Like, it's a great chorus. And I love... So when I heard Do You Want to Get High, I was like, oh my gosh. And then I heard LA Girls, and I read an article on Rolling Stone, and it was one of the, what we're listening to now, you know, and LA Girls was on it. I'm like, I haven't heard it yet. And so I clicked on the video or whatever, and I was like, what? This is, where has this been? Like, it was like, I felt like this was the closest to Blue, Pink, you know,
yeah,
era song feeling, you know, and it's and it's fantastic.
It is. And but recently my favorite song, LA Girls, for a long time I would have said, in fact, LA Girls I think was like my, when I ranked all the songs, was like, was top 10 for sure, maybe like was like top 5.
Wow.
Something like that. I really liked it. But no. Whoops. I didn't skip ahead. But recently, every time I turn on the album, this is a song that gets me. I love singing along to it. California Kids.
Got that Beach Boy. I mean, this is very Beach Boy.
Yeah. When you wake up, yeah, I don't know. I just I've been digging that song a lot lately, and yeah, I don't know.
So it's a great song. Fake Smiles and Nervous Laughter is the B side.
Yeah.
Off of this, really good.
Yeah, and I really like that song. I like the other B side better though. The Friend of a Friend. I'm just a friend of a friend. And
yeah, it's really good too. I probably have this too low, if I'm being honest. But whatever.
Converted you. All right. All right. So next one. In your number three, which was, this is actually the biggest gap in the albums. This was my number 10.
That's incredible to me.
And it's not because I don't like it. Yeah. It's that there's just enough songs on there that I don't love. And there's not enough songs that I'm constantly going back to. It just slips down. Like, the really good songs, they're good, but they're not, like, epic for me. And I'm not, like, clamoring to listen to them all the time. And there's some songs on here I don't like. Like,
yeah.
But, anyway.
My favorite song, I'm guessing.
It's not one of my favorites. I don't dislike it. It's a good one. We'll... why do you like it so much?
So, I don't know. this album has, like, some sentimentality to it that I don't really understand why. I was on my mission when this came out, and I heard Keep Fishing. They played on the radio there. I'd catch little snippets of it, and Dope Nose, you know. And, I don't know. Like, I just latched onto it. I never heard the whole album until I got home, and I just loved it. I would listen to it a lot, put my headphones in, and Death and Destruction to me is just like, it's a short and sweet song, but it's got a lot of, I guess I lean more towards the emotional songs a little bit. Like, I just feel like the little solos in it, the
guitar work on this album is good, and it's better than Green really Album. Good. Like, hands down.
Yeah. Just a little, I don't know why, but Death and Destruction has been my favorite of this album probably from the beginning, honestly. When I finally listened to it, and there's something about this song that I just love, you know? But I can't, you know, I'm horrible at explaining my feelings, but yeah. I really love it. Yeah.
There are some really good songs, like Keep Fishing. Really good song. Dope Nose is a great song.
Even their stuff like Space Rock, December, Possibilities. Like, Possibilities is a great song. Like, I don't know.
I really like Possibilities.
Yeah.
That's a great song. But, well, let's get to it. Your favorite song was Death and Destruction. Yeah. Got the drums. That is great.
Yeah.
I want to say Rivers whipped out just that guitar part at a concert I went to.
Oh, really?
It's like part of a medley or something, and he whipped that little part out, and I was like, yeah. But
cool.
Anyway, but my favorite is American Gigolo.
It's a great song too.
I love this. It was big. Like, Green Album was just huge. Super popular. had those really slick guitars, and then kind of brought the grunge back with this one, and then people hated it, and then they made pop songs.
I love that they brought the rock back.
Yeah, it really, really good album. Anyway, so we're getting into our number twos, and we are actually not going to talk about one. We are not the same. We are not the same. We flip-flopped our number one, number two, and anybody who is a big Weezer fan, probably one they already know. But my number one is your number two, and that is the Blue Album. I remember Nick bought this, our brother Nick, who's in between me and you, and it was one of his first batch of CDs. I remember we went to the mall in Tri-Cities. He got this, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and something else. I can't remember. He bought three CDs, and I don't think I'd even heard of Weezer when he bought that.
Yeah.
And as he listened to it, and I don't know if I loved it right away, but we listened to it so much, and it, I don't know.
Yeah.
So good. A lot of sentimentality, a lot of feels.
The Blue Album to me, I mean, even though it wasn't my number one, is literally the perfect album of all time. Like, I mean, just from start to finish, that riff of
My Name Is Jonas.
Like, amazing.
I am of the opinion that every concert should start with My Name Is Jonas.
Oh, 100%.
They did that during that during the one with Panic! At the Disco, and I feel that's the way they should start every time.
Yeah.
Just knock the door down.
There's not a weak song on there. Like, I can't think of one song where I'm like, I don't want to listen to this one today. I literally, when I start Blue Album, I go from 1 to 10, and it's not a question, you know? It's just the perfect album.
Yeah, you said everything. Just so many days and nights and just listening to this album. And I as many times as I've listened to every single song on this album, you think it would get old eventually? Nah. It just keeps going and being awesome.
Yeah, and it's, I don't know if it's for you, but it's such a did you lose me? It's such a powerful memory for me, for like just everything. Like, I remember that time. Like, I remember when we were really into it. I know me, you, and Nick would listen to it a lot, and we went to the Puyallup Fair. You know, parents were selling popcorn, and we were able to go around. And do you remember the first time I saw, there was a girl who was wearing a Weezer? It was a Weezer shirt.
Was it the blue one that said Weezer, the one that I had?
No, it was, I believe it. Oh, maybe it was. But anyways, I remember seeing it and being like, oh my gosh, I'm not the only one who loves this band. Like,
right.
Like, other people love this. And it was like at that point where I'm like, okay, these guys are awesome. And I think the generation of kids our age, just they're Weezer fans, or they're not, or they hate them, but most of them are, you know.
But they know them and can sing along with every word.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. Oh, I hate, you know, even Nick probably today.
Right.
He's tired of Weezer, isn't he?
I think so. Yeah, I think so. My blue Weezer shirt, I had that for years. I kept it for years. I eventually outgrew it, and I tried to hold on to it, and I don't know what happened to it, and it's maybe the saddest thing in my life. I love that shirt.
I've owned one Weezer shirt, and it was the Weezer shirt, you know, the white shirt with the red around the sleeve,
mm-hmm.
and that said, if it's too loud, turn it down.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah. That's a great shirt.
Yeah. That's the only one I've ever owned.
It's hard for me to buy shirts now. The last shirt I bought was the fan club one, part of the fan club bundle. And it's a pretty cool shirt. Yeah. I was gonna wear that one tonight, but I couldn't find it. I don't know what happened to it. It's got shoved away somewhere. But the hard part for me is I am a 3X and long.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, Weezer refuses to sell that size. I actually emailed Manhead, I think is the name of the company, and I said, it's actually a great email. I should find it somewhere and read it. But I was like, hey, I've been rocked out since 94, and there's two things I love, food and Weezer. And I just need a bigger shirt, man. Gotta give me triple X and long if possible. And because I'm just so tall and big. But anyway, they laughed at me. They said, oh, we'll keep that in mind. But every shirt since then taps at it 2X, I think. But great memories. Anyway, you're let's go over. We actually matchy-matchy on the same song, on our favorite song. Which is weird since we love all of them, but
yeah.
And I think this is probably, it's the emotional song. It's a song, it has a dark edge to it.
Yeah.
It's sad and just rocking and awesome.
Yeah. The video to me, the best music video of all time too. Like, and it's not, it's whatever.
Yeah.
I just love it. Yeah.
Apparently the house where they filmed that and the house where they were living at that time is going to be demolished soon. There's somebody on the Weezer fan club who lives in the area keeps going by there and checking on it to see, like, it's tagged to be demolished and it's still standing. That'll be a sad day though, I think.
I mean, it was a crappy house in 94, so.
Yeah. I mean, but it's like, it's part of rock history, I think.
Yeah.
So sad. Too bad nobody can come up with the money just to save it. But probably gonna put some fancy apartments or something on there. All right, and without further ado, your favorite album and my number two is Pinkerton. And this is a classic debate every Weezer fan has. If your favorite album is not Blue Album or Pinkerton, you're probably lying and just saying that for attention.
And you're not a Weezer fan.
Yeah, I think you can be a Weezer fan. You have ulterior motives.
So, Pinkerton to me was, I think everybody's, it's just so much, it's so different. It verges, it's how Blue Album was like the perfect pop rock album. Pinkerton was the perfect, rock punk. I don't even know.
It's the best of emo. It's not really an emo record, but a lot of emo bands are out there. Is like, yeah, Pinkerton was a huge influence, and if you like emo or not, emo's a little too screamy for me most of the time. But it has that emotion, and just every song is just bringing it. And unfortunately, it wasn't well received. At first,
I remember the Rolling Stone article where it said the third or second worst album of the year, and I took that personally. I was devastated. I was like, "What are you talking about?
Have you even listened to Across the Sea?"
So funny story about Pinkerton is I hadn't heard it yet. That just dropped, and we went to the mall. Was it Sam Goody? What was it?
Sam Goody or EFY were the two music stores in the mall back then.
Yeah. So anyways, Pinkerton was sold out. The CDs were sold out. We got there late, but they had the cassette of it. And I was like, we're buying it, and we're in the Quantum, and we listened to it on the way home. And Kevin, I remember it was me, you, I think Nick was there, but we went back, and I listened to it over and over. And then we got home, and I was listening to it on my tape recorder or whatever, and Kevin Page came over for some reason.
Yeah.
And I was like, dude, you gotta listen to this album. And I'm like trying to rewind and fast forward, and like, and he's like, just, and Kevin's like, yeah, sounds pretty cool, man. And he like just then went back to talking to you guys, and I was like, this album sucks apparently. No, but it encapsulates my junior high, freshman year, I listened to it so much. I wore that tape out, and then eventually bought the CD, and I've bought this album probably four times, honestly, four different times.
I have illegally downloaded it many a times.
It's just an emotional, it gives me an emotional reaction every time I listen to it.
Yeah, and I think, way back then you talked about songs from the Black Cult, and this is kind of like the leftover and like the stuff that made this and has that theme. Yeah. And I still want a real like finished copy of Songs from the Black Hole. Like from getting to end. I want it put together. I want someone to produce this a stage version of it.
Yeah.
And go to town. And this has all the best parts, honestly. You know, there's some good stuff. Blastoff's a really fun song and that stuff. But this is the best. And it has and some other stuff. The reason why this isn't number one for me is I actually don't love Falling for You.
I
still like it. It's probably like a top 40 like Weezer song of all time. But of the two albums, like the Blue and Pinkerton, it's by far like my lowest rated.
So there is one song on this album that probably wouldn't be in my top 100 Weezer songs.
Oh, really? Which one?
Yeah. Get You.
Oh, I love Get You.
I don't hate it, but there's something about it. I think because Tired of Sex is like the perfect Weezer song. Like I love that song. And then it's almost like a drop off, and I just like almost dislike it because it follows one of the best Weezer songs of all time.
Okay. I'll actually amend my earlier statement. Every Weezer concert should start with My Name is Jonas or Tired of Sex. One of the two.
Yeah.
Tired of Sex. I always have like this little fantasy, maybe. Calling it fantasy is weird. But like if I was ever like on like one of those like singing shows like American Idol or The Voice, I would do Tired of Sex, and I would 100% run across the stage and like go down on my knees and I'm down on my knees. Exactly. it's such a good song. Such a good song. But your favorite song from Pinkerton. Oh, it's Tired of Sex. No, let's just listen to it right now. Again. Jamie hates that.
Jamie hates it?
She hates that first part of it.
I love it. That's a good
song. I just want to listen to the whole thing. Anyway, but that album, I want to hear that one live. I don't think I have.
Yeah, I want to watch freaking Rivers shredding that solo.
Yeah,
it's the best Weezer solo, I think, hands down. I don't think there's one that comes close to it. I mean, there's a couple that are really good, but the solo in Tired of Sex is almost, I like it almost as much as the song as a whole. Like, it's just, it's freaking just, it's shredding. It's, I've tried to learn it multiple times and I'm horrible. I can't figure it out, but I don't know. This song gives me an emotional reaction every time. Just, I don't know.
It's a great song.
It's such a great song. Yeah.
But, and my... And,
probably a little problematic, but
part of the song is like the ironic like emotion to it, like he you know, it's following the Madam Butterfly. He's like, he's saying, I'm tired of sex, I'm tired of not having something more than these meaningless relationships. That's my take anyway, but I think that's what makes the song so great, right? You know, it's like, why can't I be making love come true, or is that the lyric?
Yeah.
Oh man, in the fields. Anyway, but my favorite song on this album, and actually my favorite Weezer song of all time.
Can I guess?
You should know. I think we've talked about it.
The Good Life?
The Good Life, yeah. I love this song.
Yeah.
From the beginning.
Yeah. Good. The video is awesome.
Yeah, with the Mary Lynn Rajkub, or however she says her name. Dumping the pizza. yeah. Anyway, just great album, great songs. We have been talking a long time.
Sorry about that.
No, this is by far my longest episode. It's going to take forever to upload to YouTube. thanks for coming. I couldn't imagine, maybe... If we could do like a trio, me, you, and like Jordan or something, that would be fun. But
Jordan would have loved to have been on this for sure.
I'll have to get a hold of him and maybe we can talk about Deftones or something, even though I don't really like the Deftones.
he'll talk way more about them than I would, but I love him.
So, yeah. Anyway, this has been EdotGdot and Friends with my friend Joseph Killian. And I will see you. Oh, wait. We have another slide. Why am I wrapping this up already? Do you have any final thoughts? I feel like we talked this out too much.
Yeah, Weezer will always be my favorite band. I really don't think there's ever going to be a band that'll come along that will ever supplant them.
I feel like your favorite band of all time has to come during your teenage years. Yeah. And if they're not, or maybe like early 20s.
Yeah.
But every year you get away from there, it's like, yeah, I like stuff, but how emotionally invested can I get into Miley Cyrus or even like, and if you like rock is not, yeah, it's just hard to find a good rock band these days.
Yeah,
I've been listening to Jet a lot lately. You're listening to Jet? Yeah. Man, they were so good. I'm so sad that rock died on them.
Yeah,
because they could have had a good run.
I agree.
They were good. And the Strokes. Strokes are good.
Actually, they have a couple songs that are probably top 50 of my favorite all-time songs.
Last Night. I love Last Night.
Yeah. My favorite one, well, no, I can't remember, so never mind. But Undercover Darkness? No, what's that song called? Yeah, I can't remember the name of the song, but it's really good.
Anyway, Weezer's great. I don't think there's anything else to say. Suzanne, Jamie, which one's your favorite?
Ooh.
I married both of them.
Suzanne, I think.
Ugh.
Eeks out. Ugh. Jamie.
Ugh.
No. I know that is horrible for you specifically. We won't get into why, but
I divorced one of them.
Suzanne is great, man. Yeah, just actually that was a little tidbit. That's I sing that song to my girls to bed like for years.
That's sweet. It was that song, yeah. It is a great song, and I hate that it's ruined for me forever. But but I married a Jamie, and Jamie is a great song, and so. Anyway,
Michael and Carly was another great song from that era that I love.
Yeah, and you know, that's actually like the B-side or like the bonus song on Death to False Metal. Like, there's another version. It's like a different, slightly different version of it, and it's actually a pretty rocking version. I don't know if you've heard it, but
I haven't.
And so I didn't count it as a Death to False Metal song just because it's not. It, you know, it lived way before that came out.
Right.
In my heart, you know, so but
well, good times. Yeah, I had a good time, Elden.
Yeah, it's late for you. You gotta go to bed.
Oh yeah, all right, man.
Anyway, it's been good. I need to come up with a tagline.
Where? I'm making a YouTube video, Bev.